Facebook and Instagram, we have been posting all the wonderful work you did with us during our event planning, along with Andre sir and Melroy chef, Meher ma'am, Prasad chef, and Susan ma'am, and Glenn and Sana. Y'all put on with the batch of 2020 this absolutely fabulous event called Awfully Good. So if anybody is wanting to see all those pictures, please go on our Facebook page, Don Bosco College Hospitality Studies. Or you'll even see it on Jashan's Facebook or even mine. I welcome you back. And for those who weren't with us last week, let me, you know, I'm going to embarrass you again. But it needs to be said, you've worked really hard to make sure that you have got to this fabulous stage at such a young age. So first, yes, Jashan Sippy is a Bachelor of Architecture. An architecture student who is teaching us about food through 3D printing. He's done his MSc in International Business. He's also been certified by the Kiev International Culinary Academy and the European Bartenders School. I honestly need to have a meal with you since both will be combined then. Founder Sugar and Space, a food-focused design and innovation agency, creating meaningful connections for a sustainable food future. And founder of Edible Bites, India's premier 3D printed food. I have to say that we have been extremely fortunate to have Jashan with us for the last couple of years, you know, mentoring our students, mentoring the staff with all these brand new cutting edge technology that is going to help food get to the next level. So with that, I welcome you, Jashan. And before, may I just say one little announcement, because there are a lot of 12th standard graduates who have got their results and who are excited. And so to all of you, congratulations that you have passed. You've done very well. We look forward to welcoming you into Don Bosco College Hospitality Studies, where you will get to do all these wonderful things with us in the next 3 years. So again, thank you, Jashan. And I hand it over to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. Good to see you again. And cheers from my peppermint tea today. So it was absolutely a pleasure working with, I think, all the students in the event planning series for Awfully Good. And what we really tried to do and promote, I think, was not only sort of the use, and we sort of trained the students with the theory and knowledge of the 3D printer for food, which was something that's unusual and quite new, especially in the Indian market. But we really tried to promote a bigger picture with Awfully Good. I think using offcuts of the animals, we were really trying to educate people that by consuming the full animal, it's again a more sustainable method of consumption. And of course, there are certain, let's say, negative thoughts or connotations towards eating offcuts. And by using the 3D printer, we were sort of able to present them in an unusual or a beautiful way, which sort of masks the negative connotations people might have when they know that something is brain or liver, but it tastes delicious, so why don't we eat it? So without further ado, I'm going to share my screen. Just let me know if you're able to see it and hear the audio. Just a thumbs up will be good.
Order? Might be an awfully small one.
I believe it's a molecular synthesizer of some kind. Similar to a protein resequencer, but far more advanced. To water. Cold. I saw a similar device in a Tarkalian vessel. It was capable of replicating almost any inanimate object.
If we had one of these in engineering, we could make all the spare parts we need. I wonder what else is on the menu. one pan-fried catfish. Smells like the real thing.
Well?
Not bad.
I doubt there's a catfish within 130 light years.
Its genome is stored in Enterprise's computer, as is the recipe. The station evidently scanned our database.
It would have been nice to have been asked. I can only imagine what else this thing knows about us.
Captain, you gotta try this.
Thanks, but I'll stick with whatever chef's serving. I'll be on the bridge.
Order?
And that is sort of where we begin with. Are you able to see the presentation, ma'am? Great.
Yes,
so,
sir.
This makes us come to the first question. How close or how far away, and when will we be eating like this? How far is technology today from sort of us saying something in thin air and it sort of providing us something that's completely edible and like in Star Trek, maybe even delicious tasting? So the definition of three-dimensional food printing, which is also, by the way, called food layered manufacturing, it is a digitally controlled robotic construction process which can build up complex 3D food products layer by layer. So again, please note we've highlighted certain words. So it's digitally controlled, which means there is some electronics involved. It is complex. So we're trying to say that what the 3D printer can do is sort of more complex or more fine than what we could easily do by hand. And it's something that is being built on layer by layer. So I request all students to please mute your audio. Thank you. So if you look here carefully, you can sort of see that this is a 3D printed item of food, and you can sort of see the striations or the layers that have been built on. So before we dive deep into 3D printing of food, let's understand two basic methods of manufacturing of food. Method one, as you can see here, is almost carving, and that is called a subtractive layer of manufacturing. We have cake that we've stacked up, but we're eating away from the entire form in order to sculpt it. Method number two is additive, which is basically we're trying to add on, for example, layers. So our 3D food printer is an additive method of manufacturing. So if you were carving and making bread sculptures, for example, that is a subtractive method of manufacturing. Constructing a beautiful croquembouche tower is additive. Scooping, at the act of scooping pieces of watermelon or any kind of fruit, is subtractive. Carving an avocado is again subtractive. Constructing all the layers for a beautiful, delicious, flaky milfoy is additive. Carving a cake is subtractive. Carving chocolate is subtractive. This one's tricky because you sort of have a gingerbread house. If you actually talk about cutting out the templates from your main sheets of gingerbread, then that is subtractive. But when you talk about assembling the different pieces together, it's additive. So now let's get into a sort of background with 3D printing in general. Again, if you guys have any questions, please feel free to put them into the chat. So Chuck Hull invented stereolithography, which was the first method or scientific process used for 3D printing, and that was in 1984. By 1986, he was quick and patented the whole process of a 3D printer that uses this method of stereolithography. And the file format that was used was an STL. Till today, with the printer that we also use currently, we have STL formats of files being used for a 3D file. In 1988, there were different companies that started developing 3D printers. And then by 1996, finally the word 3D printing was used for the first time. And by 2004, we started printing food. And about in 2010, the first ever personal 3D printer was sold. So maybe in a few years, each one of us, just like we have microwaves and ovens, could start having 3D printers in our homes. So I'm going to show you a quick demonstration of the printer.
Everything, yeah.
So the printer is a portable, like almost the size of a briefcase, that folds open.
The
fill up the cartridges.
So this is the cartridge.
This is the technology is within this part of it.
This is what you replace, but this is also reusable, so you can clean this in the dishwasher, for example.
And this is a touchscreen screen. I don't know if you can see it in a good way.
Yeah.
So then you just press it and.
So what is this, cream cheese?
Yeah. This is cream cheese, yeah.
It's beautiful.
Yeah, it looks cool, right? You really see that it's like.
And the lines, I think, because of the layers, just give it so much character.
Yeah, exactly. Super. Yeah, you really see the texture, and that's really, that's 3D printed, which is.
So this is the collection. It has like more than 100 shapes, differing in size. There's some. I will try to make your logo.
This is how you have a back end.
I'm so excited.
Design.
So to select the black and the
or you
white.
You can even search any logo, for example, or a 3D file in an STL format to start printing directly.
Do it like this.
I think
so this when I was in the Netherlands.
Convert it. So it's very. For example, I can add something. I can draw. I don't know.
You can
a
even
butterfly.
Make your
so
own.
Here, this is the 3D file, as you also see in the studio, and then I can. So I can prepare to print. Wait, I'll first show you. So that's why it's quite advanced. It has all these settings. So an opening of the nozzle, the height of the layer. So I can change all of these things. I can here change. The infill percentage, so for example, 84%. This is actually the G-code, and it's visualized here, so I can even see
you
here
how
it's
how the whole
building
form
up
will be
the printing built. Process. To the printer, which is via Wi-Fi,
mm-hmm.
So it's a wireless connection. So I have connected to the printer. Yeah, it's very quick.
And it's a wireless connection, you send over the file to the printer, and then you watch the magic happen. And so a lot of the students have had the opportunity to sort of work with the printer in person while we were using it in school. So you must be wondering now, what can be printed? So can milk be printed? Can potatoes be printed? Can meat be printed? And the answer to all of that is yes, provided they are treated in a certain way. So let's dive deep into printable food materials and what we can print. So the first thing we need to understand is the concept of a hydrocolloid. It's basically a substance that forms a gel in the presence of water. So this is essential for the formation of anything which we put into the cartridge, which becomes an edible ink. So there's the first category of material is called natively printable material. So that is already in a hydrocolloid or a hydrogel form. So things like cake frosting, smooth buttercream, cream cheese, melted chocolate, they can all easily be extruded coming out of a very narrow sort of tip. And that is great for 3D printing. So they are natively printable materials. Cream cheese, for example, we've printed them in college, and we get even forms, three-dimensional forms like the octopus. Or butter sculptures are a great and really easy, you just melt, you have the butter at room temperature, so it's smooth and printable, fill the cartridge in, and you can sort of print them out, chill it, pop it into the fridge and transfer it for service. The second group of food material is non-printable traditional material. So something like potatoes, for example, or rice or fruit and vegetables, they need added hydrocolloids to be made printable. So we sort of have to either puree these down, add sort of liquids or setting agents, and then we're able to print them. Make sure that you don't forget to sieve all your items. So a lot of the times what we do at Sugar and Space is we use leftover food waste to sort of 3D print. Just a second. So we call these items of food edible bites. That is sort of exactly what we are trying to do, promote sustainability or transforming what otherwise would be considered to be food waste, and really giving it a second life through 3D printing. I'm just going to share my screen. So we looked at natively printable material and we looked at traditional material that can be printed. Let's look at alternative ingredients, and we had gone over this a little bit last week. So these are sort of new foods or superfoods that are extracted from sources like algae, fungi, seaweed, and insects as sources of protein and fiber. So in the Netherlands, there is a food designer called Chloe Roetzebelt. And she sort of uses the residues from agricultural and food processing and transforms them into biologically active metabolites. So if you actually see the substrate of these things are 3D printed forms, and it's sort of a live piece that actually grows the mushrooms in it, and then it's served as a canapé, and the entire item is then edible. So it's quite unusual that you don't have any, let's say, bowl required to serve this, but it's sort of it is a food material that is allowing food material to grow within it, and then the whole thing is consumed. So let's try and identify what might be native, what might be non-printable traditional, and what might be alternative. So we have cricket chips that are 3D printed, and in this case, given that it's coming from cricket, yes, the insect, we would classify it as alternative. Cookie dough is something that is, again, traditional non-printable material because our cookie doughs normally are stiff. So when you're trying to 3D print with a cookie dough, for example, you really have to up your content of liquid, which is water or milk, basically the principle of using hydrocolloids, in order to make the material flow out of the nozzle really well. We use different flours. So this was a millet flour that we use to create 3D printed crackers. You can even do this with semolina for pasta. Chocolate is something that is, again, melted chocolate is natively printable. Seaweed cracker, So now the catch here is that the seaweed cracker is not 3D printed, but the, let's say, the ornamentation on it is 3D printed. So although it is seaweed, which is alternative, we'll call this natively printable, as it's some sort of puree. Looks like it could have been like a spiced mayonnaise or something piped onto it. And then something like pumpkin is a non-printable traditional material that you have to sort of cook, puree, work with in order to start making it printable. We're going to look at a very special project within the realm of 3D printing. And that is called the specialization dinner.
I'm traveling to Eindhoven in Holland. I want to find out more about 3D printed food and the role it could play in the future of food production.
So I'm here to meet two young university students who have formed a company called Upprinting. They take wasted food that nobody wants, it's just going to become garbage, and instead they turn it into fancy, luxurious food that high-end restaurants want to use.
Vita Brucken and Elzelinde van Doleveert started their company in late 2018. It could play a part in recycling some of the 1.3 billion tons of food that gets wasted worldwide every year.
So in Europe, the average is about 20% food waste, and then worldwide it's one-third.
Here, they blend food waste together with seasonings for taste and turn it into a paste, which is then used to print the food.
We can use this technology to create attractive food that really gains value and people are willing to eat it again.
After printing, the food is baked and dried, giving it a second life.
Currently, it's not quick enough for like mass production, but that might be a possibility, but we're first focusing on the restaurants.
Restaurants, along with bakeries and caterers, are also a key client of nearby company Biflow. It sells its 3D printer worldwide at a cost of 3,900 euros.
Hi, I'm Patrick.
Hi, how are you?
For now, it's really like beautiful food. It's food that cannot be made by mold or by hand, for example.
But developments are ongoing. Experts predict the 3D food printing market will be worth over $500 million by 2023.
I don't believe it's going to stay these small printers. We're already looking into ways, for example, to make food based on your DNA. We should be able in the future to make food that is good for your body, different than for your neighbor or for your children or for your husband or wife.
And this ganache is for me.
Oh my, it's very good. I feel sort of bad destroying the FT like this.
Beyond beautiful food, 3D printers' ability to improve the appearance and edibility of healthy foods could also enhance the diets of the young, the obese, or the elderly. In Sweden, for example, 3D printed food will be trialed at care homes by the end of this year. Also, protein sources less damaging to the environment than livestock, such as insects or algae, could be printed into more palatable forms. But I'd like to see some 3D printed food at an actual restaurant. Jasper Kortschmidt is head chef at the Lounge.
We use it up from the butter and the bread to the starters, to the main courses and the desserts. We want it as an additive to our dishes, just the extra, the surprise element in our creations that we make every day.
This cream cheese will take 5 minutes to create.
You can just see all the different layers, so it's like a bit of a maze.
Yeah.
But it's early days for 3D printed food, so it's still very much about embellishments and marketing.
Something you can show your restaurant with, you make an advertisement with, people want to come, want to see, are curious in what it is.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Right now, it's hard to say whether it will scale up, but it is going to be an industry worth keeping an eye on over the next 5 to 10 years.
It's very good.
So there you sort of have it. You've seen the sort of various applications that 3D printing of food can have. Yes, it is still sort of new. It's still being developed, but it could address large global food-related issues such as food waste, which all of us generate a lot of. It could sort of help with personalization and specific nutrition requirements for different age groups of people, and as well as being commercially available just to sort of attract people in to restaurants and other eating establishments. So let's actually look at what these pros and cons of 3D printing currently are. So let's look at the advantages first. Number one is it's convenient. For example, we could set the printer to print something and then step away in a busy kitchen and do another task, and the printer will just take care of it for us. So it's definitely convenient. Currently the printers are small, so it's also convenient, for example, for me having the printer to be able to just bring it to Don Bosco, plug it into a wall, and that's sort of it. Consistency. This is something that's really important to consider. Think about if you had to pipe multiple of these through the day, and you know how important consistency is when it comes to serving in a commercial setting. Definitely, not only would your arms be hurting, but your hands would start shaking, and you sort of wouldn't be able to get crisp, sharp, consistent designs and outputs constantly. It is also really clean, quick, efficient, and reliable once it's sort of plugged in and you're comfortable with it. Like we saw in the video, 3D printed food can be customized because you're actually in charge, or you as a chef are in control of what ingredients or what proportion of ingredients you're putting in. So basically, as long as you get the consistency right, the flavor and the nutritional value is sort of very much in your control. And finally, the customization could lead to mass customization. So for example, if we have low sugar 3D printed items, then anyone with diabetes, for example, might be able to consume it and it could be good for them. Efficient manufacturing is another thing. So for example, during the lockdown, I was unable to go to the studio kitchen where the 3D printer normally sits. So I had an order. So it sort of was able to make it, I was able to do it at home during this time. And in situ manufacturing means in place. So wherever your printer goes, you're able to sort of manufacture there. And then this also allows flexible decentralized production. So we've seen a lot of sort of kitchens come up, and satellite kitchens, for example, come up, or ghost kitchens come up in the last few months. What that does is you have to go into the kitchen in order to produce this. But what happens with a machine like this, which is a portable device, which is sort of convenient to take in, it's flexibility on the person, but it's also decentralized in the sense you don't have to go to that satellite kitchen in order to use this. You don't need specific tools, molds, or human intervention for every design. So for example, if you wanted to have cookies that were shaped like flowers, you would need a cookie mold that you could, a cookie cutter, which had the outline of a flower. And if you wanted a star, you would need a cookie mold that had a star. So instead of having flower, star, smiley face, for example, all of that is sort of being able to be done by one machine and more. There's increased complexity at no additional cost. It's very good for rapid prototyping. So say this is what we sort of did during the awfully good event planning, where we really wanted to sort of see which flavors, textures, and visual designs worked to enhance a dish. So we were able to conduct rapid prototypes, testing the recipes as well as presentation in order to see, does this work, does it not? The good thing is that it is ultimately edible. So even if it didn't look great, it was not thrown away. You could just sort of eat it, versus traditional 3D printing, you sort of use materials like metal or plastic. And once you sort of create those objects, you can't sort of reuse that material immediately. And at the same time, given that you can produce on demand, you have reduced inventory. What a 3D food printer allows is it empowers the customer to co-create. So if somebody, like when for the first time I saw the printer and I was in the Netherlands, and the company sort of showed me the whole process of, oh, I've sourced your Sugar and Space logo from the internet, and now I'm going to show you how I'm sort of working on the tool and then sending it to the printer, and then we'll output it in something that's edible and then you can eat it. It sort of gives, made me feel like I was a part of the process. And then finally, you can store and distribute these designs electronically, which means, let's say, I created a design while sitting away from college and the printer was in college, I could just sort of send it over the internet, and you would be able to print the design that somebody else worked on elsewhere. Again, you could use this alternative ingredients like the seaweed, like the mycelium, etc., to create new food. And it also allows you a large design freedom with experimentation. When it comes to personalization and well-being, there's a lot of health opportunities because you can actually create recipes which cater to your diet. So for example, what you're seeing in this image is traditionally, let's say if somebody is of a certain age and is unable to chew or unable to swallow their foods, it has to be sort of soft. What the 3D food printer allows is, in general, if you think about it, everything that's so mushy, so you'd have mushy peas, you'd have mashed potatoes, you'd have a pureed carrot, and it's sort of all very unappealing and therefore unappetizing. But with a 3D food printer, you could sort of take advantage of its ability to create good looking designs. And then people who are unable to chew, for example, in elderly homes in Sweden, as we saw in the video, 3D food is sort of given to them so that they sort of, with their help of their visual appeal, their appetites grow and therefore they eat and therefore they sort of are giving their bodies enough nutrition. We can talk about sustainability or environmental friendliness. So like we saw, reducing food waste or using insects as a substitute for meat or using leftovers that you can just sort of make into these edible inks and ultimately print. At Sugar and Space, we use the 3D food printer to actually bring people together. So this was one of our events, and the entire 3D printed dessert called Nectar with edible flowers and 3D printed honeycomb cookies were sort of placed all over a table and people sort of came together to eat it as a social experience. So yes, while there are a ton of advantages, there are also a set of challenges that come with the printer. Of course, some of you brought this up last time when we did the first thing about technology and food. Yes, there is a cost, especially right now, attached to a single printer. But over time, once it's mass produced, once there's sort of economies of scale that are achieved, the cost will ultimately come down. Compatibility is also sort of a challenge. While the printer is sort of able to connect wirelessly to, let's say, a Mac computer as well as a Windows, you might sort of have difficulty in the software that's required to convert the files from a static JPEG image, for example, to a STL or a G-code file that is what is used for a 3D printed output. Acceptance. A lot of people might sort of be skeptical about trying or accepting that, hey, this could be the future of food and this is real food and it could be doing good to the environment, can be good for me, it can look great and can be delicious. But I think that'll sort of come with time as well. Of course, capacity. So you saw that the printer is sort of able to print out at one time a design as much as the capacity of its cartridge. So you have to sort of keep refilling it. It's not an unlimited, so you can't, let's say, easily produce a meal for 100 people with a single printer. Material inflexibility, given that the food currently comes out of a very fine tip or a nozzle, the material, even though there's a wide range of material like we saw that can be printed, the output is always a sort of sieved puree that is very fine and can come out of the nozzle. Finally, there's lack of industry standards. Again, this is because it's not something that's so widespread. So therefore, there aren't so many guidelines, rules, or regulations around shelf life or around handling of the printer or around maintenance and things like that. Again, we saw a small design, for example, can take anywhere between 2 minutes to 10 minutes. So the one we saw in the previous video took about 5 minutes to print. So of course, this is also sort of being updated and worked upon, but it is something that could be achieved in the near future, but currently it is sort of not like in Star Trek, we saw, hey, give me water and it just appears. So we're gonna look at another company that uses 3D food printing in their practice.
In Holland. I want to find out more about 3D printed food and the role it could play in the future of food.
current livestock system is unsustainable for the environment, and it's important to find a solution to this urgent problem. Hi, I'm Giuseppe Scionti, and I'm the inventor of the first 3D printed plant-based beef stick. Novameat is a startup focusing on food tech that tries to change the current livestock system and change the food supply so that in the future we have alternative to animal meat in the supermarkets and also in restaurants. The technology that I developed is able to use bioprinting strategy and adapt them to generate a meat substitute. In the last 10 years, I've been working as a researcher and assistant professor in the field of tissue engineering. When I was able to build a tissue that really resembled an animal tissue, I thought, why can't I use this technology and apply this to gastronomy so that I could generate a meat substitute? The products that are already in the market are either burgers that are plant-based but taste like real meat, or soy-based substitutes that have the texture of an actual fibrous piece of meat but not the taste. The idea of Novameat is to try to join forces between the texture and the taste so that we can have a product that is a piece of fibrous meat that tastes like a real beefsteak. I believe that in 5 years, Novameat will have a team that will allow the project to grow both to go to restaurants and also to go to supermarkets so that our products can impact the system very much. European Union should invest more in the field of plant-based and clean meat research to bring these technologies to market and to have alternatives to animal meat. My wish is that in the near future we will have a different food supply system that is healthy, that is more efficient and more sustainable for the environment.
So we sort of saw now how the 3D food printer was sort of able to create striations in different directions to really sort of give you that imitation of the fiber in meat, which then therefore the texture and mouthfeel can sort of be manipulated to mimic real meat. So then what is this scope of 3D food printing? So there's a forecast that says that the global additive manufacturing, remember additive manufacturing, sector reached 3 billion sales in 2013 with an annual growth of 30%, with over 2.3 billion in 2012 and 12.8 billion by 2018. The forecasted growth by the end of 2020 is 21.3 billion. It would be interesting to see how the current COVID situation has maybe modify these numbers. So now that you've seen this, what according to you are the different roles you as students who are now headed towards a future in which these technologies could sort of be very widespread in 5 years, for example, or longer, what kind of role could you play in the future food industry? So you can look at it like this. There's a different areas that you could target with 3D printed food. You could look at large food companies and manufacturers, companies like Hershey's and the chocolate company and Barilla, the pasta company in Italy, sort of have already employed and used 3D food printers to create special Kisses chocolates for Hershey's as well as for 3D printed pasta in Barilla's case. You could target the food service industry, so places like catering, restaurants, sports and health centers with a special focus on the nutrition aspect of 3D printed food. You could target retailers like the supermarket and sort of have 3D printed products available, crackers, for example, off the shelves, or frozen 3D printed pasta in supermarket freezers. You could target small food companies and boutique agencies like patisseries, bakeries, or chocolatiers. And then at home, we could really start focusing on personalized food based on maybe taste and or health requirements and preferences. So if you look at an entire ecosystem, this is what it could look like, for example. So if we start at a nursing home, you have sort of consumers who have, let's say, mastication issues, which is problem with chewing, or they could have various health issues, for example, diabetes, which is all filled into this database. The database is automatically connected to this satellite 3D food printing kitchen, which could then specialize their meals for them, which are then delivered to the nursing home, and then therefore ultimately the consumer is able to have enjoy their food more, as well as have more nutrition in their body. So this one is super interesting because it is about the scope or the role of a food technologist in a 3D food printing industry. So if you decide to work with a 3D food printer, what could you sort of focus on, or what areas could be interesting to you? So the first one is food ink formulation, which is what the chef at Sugar and Space does. Chef Ishita Shah sort of is now well-versed with, and she worked with you guys as well during the event planning, works on what kind of consistency, what kind of flavor should go into creating a food ink that we could sort of print. You could work on customization of products at a molecular level. So just like we saw Giuseppe with Nova Meat is really working on creating the molecules and the entire structure and tissues. So you could go into that level. Nutraceutical rich food development, again, with a focus on nutrition and health requirements. Extraction and purification of bioactive components from the food. So again, if you really go into the sort of deep levels of certain elements that make up food and then try and extract those, we could sort of start printing with those. You could maybe go into designing your own food printers. So we saw Else Linde, who was one of the founders of Up Printing Food in the Netherlands, and they are sort of developing their own food printers as well. You could work on the stability of food powders. So for example, right now, we use things like beetroot powder, which we could just work on some additives into it in order to make that printable, which you could then bake and therefore have beetroot crackers. Food safety. So this really eliminates the errors during manufacturing of food, especially in a time like Corona right now, where we want as little sort of hands dealing with our food as possible. So a 3D food printer is actually great for food safety. And then maybe actually selling food cartridges for supermarkets. So this is last because it's sort of looking at when food printers are sort of like a microwave or just like any other appliance, like a toaster that you have at home, then you would be able to buy cartridges of food at a supermarket. So before we sort of wrap up, there's one little fun video for us to see, and then we'll open up for questions. We'll be right back.
Food Inc.
So, loud little video, nice and peppy to wake everyone up. And that is 3D printing of food. So please do feel free to comment, ask questions. We're here for answering them.
Yes, thank you, Jashan. Absolutely. As enthralled as we were when we did the event, I think I'm still, I still take a breath every time I watch all these innovations because there's so much more that still has to come. The name of the food printer that you used was...
The 3D Biflow.
3D Biflow. So compared to, let's say, the people talk about the Foodini or they talk about the very expensive MarketBot replicator.
Yep.
How does this fit in with the brands that are there out there? I mean, MarketBot replicator is far too expensive. But, the other ones that are not so, how does it work?
So the personal decision I took when purchasing or investing in the Biflow versus the Foodini was the advantage, there was just a toss up between these two, right? But with the Biflow, it is more accurate in terms of output of design. So you get sharper or clearer product. And then being an architect, that sort of drew me to the output a lot more than with the Foodini. I will say though, with the Foodini, I believe, and I could be wrong, they have multiple cartridges
that you can
install at the same time. So the Foodini is actually more like almost like a microwave size. So it's a bulkier product
that
you can sort of open up. It extrudes different materials. So for example, I've seen if they want to print pizza, there would be a dough extruder, a cheese extruder, and a sauce extruder. And then it sort of prints, so you get multiple materials sort of in one. With the Biflow, you cannot do that because we have a single extruder. So you can switch the cartridge out to change your material, but you sort of have to stick to one during one print out.
All right. So just to understand is that just for the kids out there who are watching, obviously the Don Bosco kids have seen you live. They've watched all of it. It's not like you're going to get a ready-made hamburger out of it. We have not reached that point. We are still using cartridges to extrude a puree to get a product, which is then either chilled, baked, or dried to be used.
Yeah. So that's why we sort of looked at the Star Trek video to begin with, because it's not, hey, I want a burger and you get a burger. However, if you wanted a burger that was completely 3D printed, you could sort of individually print out the elements, treat each one, and then assemble it. So you could 3D print the burger buns, you could 3D print the meat as we saw. 3D printing the lettuce might be challenging at the moment, but sometime soon, you never know.
Absolutely. So my three new words for today were upprinting, which is using sustainable products to be able to, so that we're not wasting as much of food and you're turning it into something really wonderful.
Yeah.
I think we did that for one of our garnishes, right?
As well.
For the dessert, right. They used
a core of pineapple.
Right. So the core of them.
And then we made a 3D printed cracker out of it.
Wonderful. So we upprinted. Second is I absolutely love the fact that you can recreate food to look like the real thing, even though it's in absolutely smooth form for senior citizens, which is for those who have senior citizens at home, realize how difficult that is. And this would absolutely help. And then, of course, for somebody like me, I look forward to them being able to give us food that is tailored to our DNA to keep us healthier. And, of course, consistency. So just right now, if I'm a student graduate right now, what's the first thing I can do? Is it the purees? To work on different sort of purees?
I definitely think so. If you're coming from a hospitality background, so a fresh out of third year college of hospitality, I would imagine that that would be the simplest sort of thing to start off with. And then you could sort of, based on where your interests go, build the skill set required to run the printer or really study the anatomy of the recipes. But pureeing it to make it printable, I think, is definitely the first step that is possible.
Wonderful. So to all my students and all the potential graduates and hotel management students, if you have somebody who's computer savvy, join up with them. You have the software, you have the food, you can collaborate and make it into an absolutely fabulous product.
And don't hesitate to reach out to me if you want to sort of print it together, want to develop a 3D printable recipes together, just reach out.
So we have one question that someone has asked, which says, what would the approximate cost of a 3D printing machine when it comes in market, along with its durability?
So like we saw in some of the videos, currently the 3D printer, both the Fudini and the Biflow are sort of competitive. They cost about 4,000 euros or 5,000 US dollars. By the time you actually import it, etc., to India, it's about 6 to 7 lakhs of rupees. So right now, that is definitely something that's you're not going to find it in every household, right? So we definitely did say that, but that's where it currently is at as a niche sort of product.
I have another question. I think Nigel D'Souza wants to ask a question. I think till Melroy, if you can unmute him so he can ask the question. My thing to you is, now that you have a machine and people are renting it out, is that a possibility? Is that something that is possible? And you make sure that you go in with a consultant a chef consultant to help the people who are going to use it, right?
Completely. So if it is, for example, a corporate or a private event, then there will definitely be someone from my team that goes with the printer. We don't just lease out the printer.
Right.
Because of course it's extremely intricate and there are small parts and there's sort of special knowledge required to operate it. So it's not something that can be dropped off.
Right.
And that's why we sort of have an extensive training program related to being able to operate it.
Absolutely. So just for everyone to know, when Jashan mentored us with our event, we had a series of classes for our students where they were taught the basics about food 3D printing, and then they actually got into it to make certain prototypes. Then they were narrowed down to the students who would actually make the individual components for the meal that we had, which was our five course meal at Awfully Good.
Completely. And what we sort of also did, ma'am, which we skipped today, was we actually looked more detail into sort of the operation of the printer. So today we just saw a very basic overview of what it looks like and how to sort of set it up. But if you actually look at the speed at which the nozzle moves or how many designs can come at one time or what kind of pressure you're applying based on the consistency of the food, we sort of went into those type of details because we were really practicing on the printer in person.
Absolutely. Nigel has asked.
Nigel says, now that we can use meat, usually people prefer meat. How is it that you won't change the texture? So completely, Nigel. So let's address two things here. One related to 3D food printing and one not related. So the first thing is, last week we saw sort of plant-based meats or meat substitutes being developed in the market. So for example, the company called Beyond Meat or the Impossible Burger, what they've done is their patties are not 3D printed, but the sort of ingredients that they use, they even extract what tastes like the blood or the hemoglobin molecules and insert that into their plant-based meat. So when you fry the meat, you actually have the bloodiness almost of an actual piece of steak or an actual beef burger. And so that's how sort of they're using science and molecular gastronomy, etc., to sort of plug into creating these flavors. when it comes to the texture of meat and the mouthfeel. We saw, for example, with Nova Meat in Barcelona, the scientist is really sort of focusing on direction or orientation that the strands are being printed in. And sort of when you bite into it with multiple layers, it sort of has the natural mouthfeel or texture of meat. And therefore, that's sort of how people are maybe going to start adjusting or be okay with eating something that tastes like meat, but isn't meat. So we do it with mock crab meat right now for years in the country, right?
Yes.
So it's sort of, and that's sort of normalized. You don't sort of think about that many times. But maybe in a few years, we'll sort of be like that with beef or with lamb or with some other kind of red meat.
Fabulous. You know, what was the one thing that worked the most, the easiest for you? Which food, so, whether it was like butter, of course, because we did beautiful creations on butter. But besides that, which was the easiest thing to use?
Cream cheese. Super simple. Okay. Just like your Amul or Philadelphia, and you just sort of really just soften it up.
Right.
Pipe it into the bag. It gives you really nice, because it's also stable at room temperature. What happens if your sort of like chocolate looks beautiful, but it's very temperamental, we know.
Right.
For example, if you're printing in a room which is air conditioned, then the chocolate solidifies at the tip and then you're sort of stuck. So that's sort of little hard to work with. But I definitely, for me, the most, so far the most magical thing with the printer was using the carrot waste or the carrot puree, because we have so many juices in all our homes and we sort of have this pulp that's left over. But you can sort of season it, treat it, care for it, and actually make something delicious and sustainable out of it. I would love to personally sort of one day be able to, the ganna walas and the sugarcane juice, the actual husk that comes out. I've actually stopped at many ganna walas in the last year and sort of taken the husk, but it's sort of so fibrous that it's a little tough and hard to work with. So we're still working on that, being able to print the leftover husk of sugarcane.
So, you know, I have watched a really wonderful person that I had taught years ago and was now a priest, Father Warner, and he does a lot with drying foods and turning them into powders and then using them with the food, like an orange dust and a strawberry dust and, you know, Karela dust, which I would never have thought of. So can you use that as a base to have like a, you know, a simple equation? I have the dust, I have my, as you call it, the colloidal, and then form a puree with it. Are those two components being sold separately? Can that be a possibility?
So again, given that 3D food printing is not currently widespread, you're able to get these sort of flavored powders that have nutrition in them. They actually give you great printability, right? Because they're very fine.
Right.
They're not currently marketed, of course, as things that can be 3D food printed. Because
why? Right.
But definitely, I think that's a great sort of angle and way to go in terms of doable steps to make this widespread and available. We didn't talk about it today, but actually NASA has invested over, I think, $100,000 in sort of development of these sort of food pods that can be printed in space for the astronauts. Wow. Because the advantage of sort of using your dry pods is the shelf life extends to 5 years or to 10 years because they're sort of dehydrated components, right? And in space, when you have long journeys or when all of us start going to Mars, at that time, we could sort of really start seeing the use of these powdered forms that could be added with the hydrocolloid to eat 3D printed food.
Fabulous. I have a student who asked, is it being used in the hotel industry in Bombay, in India, as of now?
Yeah, as far as printing. I know, currently it is not being used. I mean, we also faced a challenge with capacity just at Don Bosco, right?
Right.
And the reason we sort of looked at the last video with the 3D printed food pop-up restaurant, you saw the number of printers.
Right.
We currently just have a single printer And that single printer, therefore, was sort of able to produce. We were not able to actually serve all our guests' liver at the same time. And we had 3D, we did the prototypes, it worked, it looked great, it tasted delicious, it printed well. But we weren't able to sort of scale it to capacity with a single printer. So that is definitely something that I think until people are sort of, it's more affordable, but also the right training is given, because right now in the typical hospitality education curriculum, you don't look at this kind of technical or technology related, you know, plug into the curriculum. So it's definitely a good start, and I'm very happy that we're sort of able to do it.
Wonderful. There's just one more question. Okay, so again, they're going back to, they're fascinated with the insects. Yeah. And I think, you know, can you elaborate a little, because we have not started eating them here. I'm sure there are tribes in the recesses of our country that are definitely eating ants. And, you know, of course, when the locusts hit, that was my first
reaction.
Can we grind them up and eat them?
Nice. For sure. There's a couple of things here, because I've actually been in touch with the insect eating experience in Milan, in Italy. And it's sort of a partnership between a food designer or a chef and a biologist or a scientist. And they sort of, they're called Entonot, which is the insect eating experience. So again, like we said, in certain very nuanced locations or very certain cultures, eating insects is widespread. So in a lot of Asian countries or in the northeast of India, for example, it's sort of normal. For places that it's not normal, this sort of trend of it being A, sustainable for the environment, and B, nutritious form of, let's say, protein, etc., is a sort of marketing way to really sell and increase or raise awareness around eating insects. What they do with the particular experience in Milan is it's a 3-course meal, and it's particularly interesting because the first course, the insects are sort of invisible. So it could be, for example, cricket chips, so you don't really know that it's cricket. Doesn't matter. Right. Someone told you. Or it's in a sprinkled or a powdered form, so you can't tell. In the second course, you sort of start seeing maybe insect parts. So if it's a chopped up maggot, for example, you might be able to identify it, which is then deep fried and is ultimately just crunchy maybe. And finally, in the third course or your main course, you're sort of served a full skewered scorpion. But if you were served a squirrel scorpion to start with, you would be completely taken aback. So they sort of, through the courses of the meal, sort of ease you into opening your mind up to consuming these insects. Whether it's a trend in the future or just another fad, I would say we'd have to just wait and see. It's not a fad because it's something that people have been doing for ages. So it's just like, just like us trying to now package all our supermarket food in plastic and then say, oh, it's bad for the environment, let's go back to the bhajiwala. We've had bhajiwalas forever.
Right.
So it's just a sort of circle that we'll go through, and ultimately, hopefully, the better one will win.
Wonderful. So with that, I'm going to thank you very much, Ashan, for this really enlightening webinar. I'm sure it has got everyone's juices flowing to figure out what they can do to enter this market, because it is the wave of the future. We look forward to working with you. I hope we can have another experience with 3D, because, you know, we only did it for 24 people, and I'm sure everyone, after seeing all those wonderful pictures, would like to be able to experience it. I truly and absolutely am fortunate that we at Don Bosco College Hospitality Studies, through one of my students, Sashi Sippy, who is your aunt, got us in touch with you, and that you have been able to mentor our students. You know, I truly and honestly am so happy that we are on this journey with you. Thank you so very much. To all the students who are watching, all the potential students, I thank you very much for joining us. To my webinar team, I thank you for making sure that this happens, for connecting with Jashan and Mr. Sauvil from ColorSpot, who's doing all our graphics, to Melroy and the students who are co-hosting, and my entire webinar team Susan Bam, Roma Bam, Andre Sir, Melroy Chef, and Prasad Chef, thank you very, very much. Jashan, we look forward to seeing you in person, truly. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jashan. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks.